I could not cope to go to work. Even though I took the medication, it started to escalate. How do I best in my life? In the first 3 weeks, I was actually in the closed unit. But I will say, it had also saved my life. The first sentence I wrote on the board was, "Jesus, help me." I had no clue that the journey would be so hard.
In the recent years, depression is becoming more and more widespread as a disease, and people are becoming more aware of how dangerous this sickness actually is. In Denmark, it is reported that over 600,000 Danes suffer from depression. And we learned from the previous videos that science proves that through your thinking, you can actually control your genetic disposition. We also heard that you have control over your mind, and your free will isn't an illusion. It is something that can actually be put to use to your advantage. Today in the studio, I have my sister Edith, who has suffered from depression, yeah, and who has actually overcome depression. Edith, can you tell us a little bit about how you started to experience depression?
I started to, it was around Christmas time. Mm-hmm. I had a job when I worked with children. And every time I was thinking to get back to the job, I start crying. And I really, really loved my job, so I couldn't understand why I always start crying when I'm thinking to get back to work. I start crying when I have to do the laundry. I start crying when I have to empty the dishwasher. Small things, it was became overwhelming. It's like I couldn't manage to do even the small things. And when I came back to work, my boss called me for a talk. And he said to me that he could feel that I'm changing. And he recommended me to contact Felt Care and have a talk with a psychiatrist. And I was like, yeah, okay, I can do that. It's not a problem. And I had a talk with a psychiatrist from Felt Care. And after the talk, he just said to me that you have a depression.
So Felt Care is an organization,
yeah,
that deals with psychiatric patients?
All kinds of help. If you have a traumatic experience at work, you can have a psychiatrist to talk to you through this accident in the job. Mm-hmm. So Felt Care is just a step to help co-workers, like, yeah, they help every people. If you have a traumatic experience, like one died at the work or something, you can contact Felt Care and they will help you.
Okay, so do you need to be a member? Do you need to pay something to be a member of this Felt Care? It's for everyone who's living in Denmark.
I think so.
Yeah?
I think so. I have never heard about that before.
Mm-hmm.
But I called them, and a psychiatrist came out and had a 1 hour talk with me. And after the talk, she just said to me, "You have a depression and you need to take this kind of medication." And I was like, me having a depression is not something I have ever heard about. Mm-hmm. And I never thought I would experience a depression. But I took the medication, but it was like, the depression just get deeper and deeper, and the medication couldn't help anything. And I just went so deep that I was like, okay, I need to end my life.
So as you can hear from Edith, that we don't, talk about just normal sadness. For example, if you lose your job, that kind of sadness, it's not just something that happens because of a circumstance that is surrounding you at that particular moment. Depression goes deeper.
It started that I was like, my husband don't deserve me. Mm. My friends don't deserve me. The world don't deserve me because I was feeling so bad. So my thoughts was the world will soon be so much better without me. My husband will be so much happier without me. My friends will be so much happier not to have me around. The church will be happier. So I was like, have the feeling that I was doing my world a better place without me. That was I was thinking of. I was just like, I wanted to die, but I wanted to make them a favor. Yeah, yeah. That was my thought. It was not like, I really want to die. I don't want to die, but I will do it for them.
Yeah, that the world, you felt that the world will be a better place without you.
Yes.
And this is the lie that depression gives people. It makes you feel like people will be better without you. You know, it makes you feel like you are, you know, trouble to whatever is surrounding you at that particular time. And this is a lie. It is a lie that, you know, should not be entertained, because Edith is a beautiful woman. She has a wonderful husband. You know, she had a job, but yet, you know, this spirit caused her to feel like, you know, you're not worth being around this world. Do you want to say a bit more about if you had plans to actually end your life?
Yes, I have plans. I was thinking about hanging myself, but I was like, okay, the one who's going to find me will be in shock. And I didn't want to cut my veins because there was too much blood, and it also make it traumatic for them who will find me. So I was thinking pills, a lot of pills, or throw me out in front of the train or a big truck. So every time I saw a big truck on the road, I was just like, okay, now I'm going to do it. Or I saw the train, I was like, I'm going to do it now. Or I was thinking about how many kinds of medication do I have in the closet. So this was the three thoughts. I was like, what is the best for me to do?
And for how long did you go with these feelings of wanting to throw yourself in front of a truck or?
Oh my God, that's difficult to see. I don't remember how.
But it doesn't really matter. It must be really difficult. Every time you look at the train, you feel like, you know, even if it's one day or 2 days, it is such a terrible experience to have.
Yeah.
Did you feel numb in yourself when you were thinking about these things? Did you feel, you know, like you were clear in your head about what you wanted to do?
I was not clear because I was just like still thinking about what is the best to do. And that was the reason I didn't do it, because I was not convinced about the three things, what will be the best. So there was just like the own mind in all that have in my mind was like, what is the best for me to do?
So you had these different options.
Yes, I have, and I couldn't choose between the three options.
You know, when we read in Mark chapter 5 about the man who was in the tombs, and you know, Jesus had crossed over to the other side, and Jesus told the demons to get out of this man that was oppressed by the demons in the tomb. They begged him to send them to the swine, and they drove the swine to their death. You know, this is what the enemy wants to do with us. He wants to wipe us off the face of the earth. You know, and this is where we need to make declarations in our lives. Edith, you talk about when you were, when you got to the psychiatric hospital, when you got help, there's some things that you talked about in your video, in your previous video, about, you know, things that you wrote. Can you tell us a bit more about that?
We went to my doctor because I was having the depression, and I should fulfill some papers. And after I did that, I was totally honest. I really was totally honest to her. And then she said to me, I want to call the psychiatry center in Ballerup and see if they can have you for a talk also. And I said, yeah, sure. And we went to the psychiatry center, my husband and I, and we had the talk. And they just said, we are not going to let you out. I was too dangerous for myself. So, and they were all booked on the rooms, but they have an office. And they said, you can have this office because you're not using that one. And I really see God's plans. Even that you are in the depression, God still have plans for me. And in that office, there was a whiteboard, big, big whiteboard. And I asked the nurse if I could have a pen. And she was like, yeah, sure, you can have a pen. And on that whiteboard, the first thing I wrote on the whiteboard was Jesus, help me. And you know, a psychiatry center, they deal with a lot of people. And when I saw that on the whiteboard, I was like, okay, she's really crazy. And they went to my husband. I said, do you know anything about that? And he said, yeah, yeah, it's so natural for her to do this. Because I also do it when I was home at the depression. I wrote notes on every find on the fridge and everything was put some notes and say, Jesus help me, or some verses from the Bible and all this kind of talk. And I had a book on me. A book written by an American author that's named Sheila Walsh. And she has been depressed, have been through a depression, and have wrote a book about it. And also became, she also survived depression and wrote a book about that. And she was the only person in my world I have ever known
to have a depression.
I have no friends. I have never heard about the depression before I wrote her book. So I climbed to this book and was like, she overcome depression, so can I. If she can do it, then I can do it.
Yes, beloved, you see the power of testimony. Just like Edith right now is sitting here and giving us a testimony saying that she has overcome. You know, we hear many stories. Recently, it's been popular that, you know, even pastors are taking their lives, but there's also stories of victory out there, you know, like Edith is one of them. Sheila Walsh, you know, an amazing writer. She's one of them who has also survived depression. So there is hope for you out there. So you screamed and you said, I mean, you screamed in your writing and said, Jesus, help me.
Yeah.
You know, and then?
I was not able to read the Bible because I didn't understand it.
No.
But 2 years before I had the depression. I got a tattoo on my leg. From the Bible, was says from Isaiah 41, that says,
you shall soar on wings like an eagle.
And you will get stronger.
Yes.
Like the eagle is stronger after it loses a feather, then it becomes stronger. And that tattoo, I just climbed to. I look at that all the time. I was like, when I'm out of here, when I'm out of the depression, I will be so much stronger than I was before. And that was my only hope. And I remember the verse in Jeremiah says, I have the thoughts of your future. It's what also written on the whiteboard.
Wow.
So I have Sheila Walsh written on the whiteboard. Yeah. I have the Isaiah's written on the whiteboard. I have Jeremiah written on the whiteboard. And that was the only thing I could climb to. And I had this really, really deep knowledge that I will get over this.
Yes.
I don't know how it will be.
Yeah.
I don't know when it will be. But I just had this in my mind. I will be stronger when I'm out of this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you had a strong desire also to live. You had a desire to survive this. You had a desire to overcome this. You know, even if you had thoughts of suicide, you still had the strength in you. And you know, this reminds me of that man we read about. This guy, he was crazy. He was in the tombs. He was cutting himself. But yet, this thing that was in him was not able to take his life. And that's the strength that we have, you know, as human beings, because God has created us with that fighting spirit. And I can hear that fighting spirit through your testimony. You know, you wrote scriptures down to remind yourself of the word of God. That is amazing. Because at the psychiatric hospital, you know, you meet many people who say they have hallucinations and they have negative thoughts and negative thinking all the time that press them and, you know, and tell them that you're not good enough, you cannot amount to anything, you know, you're good for nothing, just like the voices that you had. So continue to tell us about, you know, how the nurses actually, what did they think about you? Yes, they asked your husband. But then what else did they think? Did they ask you about these things you're writing?
No, they didn't. But you also have to say that when I went to this hospital, I have two choices. I have the choice to take the medication, and I will be hospitalized like 3 months before they can see if the medication has
taken effect.
Effect. Or I could choose the electroshock treatment. That is fast. This will make you faster healing. And we agreed to the electroshock treatment, but it also is a result of memory loss. So I don't have so much memory of my hospitalization because every second day I have a treatment, electroshock treatment. So it affects also my memory. So I don't know how, but I don't think they ever talk to me about what I have written on the whiteboard.
No.
And I had just this book from Sheila Wars. I just climbed to that everywhere I went. I had this book with me.
Yeah.
Because she was the only hope for me to overcome the depression. She was the only one I could hold on to.
Yeah.
And so I don't have so much memory of even that out of the hospital. I think a month after I was out of the hospital, we talked about it, my husband and I, and he said, I was in the closed unit for 3 weeks.
Wow.
I have no clue that I was in the closed unit. I didn't know that. I didn't know that I was so dangerous to myself that I was under 24 hours
supervision.
Supervision. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
So I was like in kind of a shock, closed unit, because closed unit for me is like really crazy people, you know? So, and I was not like so crazy.
Yeah, you're not crazy.
That I needed to be. But so it was really, I just remember when they said to me, okay, we have to move you. I thought, okay, is that because they have a room for me?
Yeah.
But that just took me from the closed unit to the open unit.
Yeah.
And suddenly I could be out in the garden without any fence.
Yeah.
And I could go to McDonald's with some other people that were hospitalized with me. And I remember when I went to the garden in the closed unit, there were fence all around me.
Yeah.
But I didn't notice.
It didn't occur to you
it was just like normal.
Yeah,
because
oh, there's fences, yeah.
I'm a psychiatrist, so of course everything is closed.
Mm-hmm.
But after I had the opportunity to get out and also go out to some friends from church to invite me out for dinner or something mm-hmm. like that, I was allowed to do that.
Yeah.
And I didn't figure out that there was two different places. Mm. I was just like, okay, now they have a room for me, so I will move. Mm. So for me, it was like me in a closed unit for 3 weeks?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's amazing. Yeah. So you can see how sick you actually were,
yeah.
and you didn't even realize it, because with depression, you look so much inwardly. The world around you almost does not exist. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
You know, when you have depression, when you have something that is bothering you deep within yourself, it's like the world is all inside you. Mm. The outside world does not exist. And that's what you experienced when you were in the psychiatric hospital. You were in a, like we say in Denmark, local afdeling, you know, where you're not allowed to go out and nurses are watching you every single minute of the day, you know. And it's really amazing, you know, that for me, I'm amazed that you still had the strength, you know, to encourage yourself. You know, you had the strength to tell yourself that you're going to come out of this. Even if you didn't realize that you're so sick, or you didn't realize that it is as terrible as someone looking from outside, you know, would see you. You know, you still had the strength within you. And for me, that's a very, very important part of your testimony. You know, there's so many people who give up prematurely, you know, but if we can just hold on. So then you were in there for 3 months. You had your electroshock treatment.
I don't think I was hospitalized in 3 months.
No, I think
it was one and a half, because it was going to the medication treatment.
Yeah.
Then it will be at least 3 months.
3 months, okay.
But with the electro treatment, it will be faster for me to recover the depression.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the reason why we choose that, because I couldn't imagine to be hospitalized for 3 months and still didn't know if the medication would work for me.
Exactly. Yeah.
So I didn't want to be something you just try things on, like an animal.
Guinea pig.
Yeah. I didn't want to be like that. Mm. So we choose the fastest and the best way to do it.
Mm.
And that was the electro treatment. Yeah.
Mm. So you have just a little bit of memory loss after all this experience, but yet you now got back to working.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you got a new job. Mm. Tell us about that.
I was fired from my old job after a half year. I came back to them because they said I was not able to do the same things I was before.
Mm.
And I think it was best for me to find another way to live. And I was fired, and I was still like confusing about, because they said at the hospital that it will take around half year before your memory is coming back and you're full recovering for that.
Mm.
And we waited for this half year to go, and still no affection of my memory.
Mm-hmm.
And we were confused about how couldn't I do the same things as I did before.
Everything
I have to start over. I couldn't find my way around in my own town. Mm-hmm. And there was a lot of small things. I was like, why is not that coming back?
Mm-hmm.
And then we went to got some test, 3 hours test.
Mm-hmm.
And then he said to me that my brain was damaged after the electroshock treatment.
Yeah.
And it will not come back. So and that's what I really was mad at God. Because it was like, okay, now I have overcome the depression.
Yeah.
Why should I also have this
memory loss
and brain damage. Yeah. Why I'm going to have that? Because now I have overcome the depression. Mm. Why do I still have to have this tree? So I went to a psychiatrist and I got out of the mad feeling, because I was really mad for a long time, because I didn't think it was fair.
Yes. Yeah.
I really didn't think God was fair. Mm. But also said that it's only 2% of people that get electroshock treatment that will get a brain damage. Mm. So I have never heard about, I have no people with electrical treatment without any problem afterward. Mm. So only 2% people that will get the treatment that can have damage for the rest of their life. And I was among those 2%. So, I will say that even though I have a brain damage, it's still the best way to treat so deep depression, because medication cannot do it. Mm. So I always recommend it. Mm. Because then I was just unlucky. And I was not unlucky, it was just like God's plan for me. Mm. And I went to another job. And after a half year, I become promoted. Mm-hmm. And now I'm working as a team leader. I started my job with 16 hours a week. Mm-hmm. Now I work 37.
Wow, yeah. Full-time job.
Full-time job now.
Wow.
And I can really see God's plans in that. And I am totally out of the old things. Mm. And I really started a new thing. Mm. So this job, I have never thought I was going to work in that packing industry that I am in. Mm-hmm. But people really, I'm good at my job. Mm-hmm. I got promoted.
Yeah.
So brain damage or not brain damage, it doesn't affect me anymore. I have learned to live with it.
Yeah.
I have learned to deal with that, and I have learned to just to get on my life, no matter what the physical says. And I'm now in a leader course. Mm-hmm. So to take more information about how to be a good leader, mm-hmm. because I am a team leader, mm-hmm. and I just wanted to be better. Mm-hmm. So I have the opportunity to take a leader course.
That's amazing. Did you hear what Edith says? She said she is good at her job, you know, as opposed to the other bad feelings that you used to have, mm-hmm. the negative feelings. You know, she is good at her job. I think that's a big thing, to be able to see something positive in your life and actually speak it out. Because we are used to speaking, negative. Mm. I'm not pretty enough. I'm not slim enough. I'm not good enough. You know, but says who? You know, we need to be able to get up in ourselves and say, you know, I'm actually good enough. I am cut out for this. You know, there's no one else who can take my place, you know. Mm. That's amazing, Edith. I am very encouraged by your testimony. And I am praying that someone out there will also be encouraged by, you know, this testimony and know that it is possible to come out of it. There is a short memory loss. There is a bit of memory loss because of the treatment that Edith got from the hospital. But other than that, you function properly. Mm-hmm. You know, you have a job. You're taking a leadership course because you're a leader. I think that's a very, very big thing. You know, and you said that it was important. In your video, you said that it was important for you to continue doing stuff, you know, going to the movies, mm-hmm. or going out shopping, or going out to eat with your friends. Why was that important for you?
Because when you are out of the hospital and you are at home, mm. and you're still have the depression, but not as you know, it's not like that you're down or anything, but you're still trying to recover things. And it is so easier just to stay in bed and feel sorry for yourself.
That's right, yeah.
It's so easier just to let things go. And especially after I also got the diagnosed with permanent brain damage, it's so much easier just to sit on the couch and feel sorry for yourself. So for me, it was like, I want to put on the makeup every day. Every Sunday I took my calendar and I fulfill every day. Maybe, and I have a friend who gave me a year card for the zoo. So maybe on Monday I'll go to the zoo. Tuesday I will clean up the whole apartment. Wednesday I went to the movies. And it was all about me, not about what do my husband want to do, what my friends want to do. It was all about what do I want to do, no matter what everybody else said. So, because it is so much easier just to stay in bed. And I didn't want my husband to come home every day from work and see his wife in nightgown and no makeup. I wanted him to get home to a beautiful wife with the makeup on, clothes on. And I really, and I have a year card to Tivoli, so it was really like the zoo, Tivoli, the movie, cleaning, do laundry, all kinds of small stuff that make, and it started to make me happy. So it was really, really important for me to stand up and say, I don't want to give up. I want my husband to get home to a wife that is happy. And the only way I could be happy is to do things that I want to do. So so it was really, and then I started to work as a voluntary because it's so hard to be without people around you.
That's right, yeah.
So I started to work as volunteer in a hospice and also an organization with homeless people.
Wow.
So one Monday I was at the hospice and the other Monday I was with the homeless people. And then I was joined the choir that was in the hospice too on Tuesdays. So I came also like colleagues, even though I only was a volunteer, I still have people to
that's right,
to do things. And so when I at work right now, I also have people that have been out of job for a long time, and I said, okay, what did you do at this time when you were have no job? And they told me I was just sitting on the couch and was television. I was like, why didn't you get out and do something voluntarily? And said, we have never thought about that. But it doesn't matter if you get paid or not paid. The matter is that you will be among people and have a responsibility for people.
That's right.
And this is also making you getting better. You're not getting better just to be by yourself all the time, but you get better if you go among people. I went to Copenhagen a lot of times just for a walk. I still have my, if I go to Copenhagen alone and have my walk, then I have a special route I'm going from, it started from Østerport station to the main station. Because it's the only walk I can do by myself. If I get other places, I will get lost. And I must call my husband and say, I'm here, can you help me home? So it's not like that. But also said that it was not always like that, because I also had days when I was really, really down. And I let myself to have one of those days. But I also promised, okay, today, you can't be allowed to be in your nightgown and no makeup and see television. But next day you are getting up again. That was my promise to myself. It is okay today to feel down and do nothing for yourself and just watch television. But tomorrow you are going up again, put on the makeup and do stuff again. So, yeah.
It's important, you know, for like my friend Edith is saying, you know, statistics state that over 1 million people suffer from stress, and the majority of these people are people who are not employed, you know, and there is an increasing number of people who feel lonely, and a large number of these people have difficulty sleeping, you know, they have depression, they are tired, and they are anxious. And we are hearing right now from Edith that it was important for her to get out of the house, see people, because one of the dangerous things about depression is isolation. You want to be by yourself. You don't want to meet people. You don't want to get up and, you know, put just lipstick. You know, a lot of men think that we do lipstick for them, or we make our faces for them. No, most of the women actually do this for us. We make our hair for us. We fix our faces for us, you know. And I hope you're hearing the underlying message here. Don't stay by yourself. Don't isolate yourself. Volunteer if you have to volunteer. Because when you stay by yourself in your own room, you get all those thoughts. You start feeling sorry for yourself. You know, when you look in the mirror and you see this person who has just woken up and the hair is a mess, then you know, you're like, oh, I look terrible. And then that starts, you know, a motion of very negative thoughts. You know, I am glad that you're sharing this part of your life with everybody who's viewing at this moment, because we don't actually think about the power of a shower. You know, there is actually power in showering. It rhymes, yeah? But just get up, do something, make yourself happy as well. You know, because it's also important. The Bible says, love yourself, love your neighbor as you love yourself. People who don't love themselves actually have a very difficult time to love other people, you know. Do you feel that you've become stronger? Yes, I know you've said that you've become stronger and you are getting a promotion at work.
Yeah, the God promises that when we are like from Isaiah, the eagle will be stronger.
Yes.
Yeah, after it has lost its feathers. And it is something happens, and it just don't need to be depression. It can be something else in your life. But if you have overcome it, you will get strong, because this is what God promises.
That's right, yeah.
And I feel so much stronger, and I feel so much easier for me to say no now. If I don't have the energy to be with someone, I have a plan with someone, and I don't have the energy, I said, I cannot do it today. Let's do it another day. So I'm feeling so much more myself now. I'm so much, I don't regret that I have to get through the depression, because it has made me so much wiser and so much stronger after this down period in my life, and I can really see God's plans. Sometimes I'm really thankful that I get through the depression, because it has given me so much more than before the depression. And I think my marriage is so much better today and so much stronger today, because we both survived. It was not only me that survived depression, it's also my husband. He survived.
Yeah.
Because he has to get to job in the morning, has to go to the hospital after work and see me so down, and have to deal with that too, and have to be a strong person for me. So we got so much stronger also together after that. And so much supporting. Yeah. So I feel my world around me is so much stronger now than it was before. We had a good marriage before my depression, but I think today we have a better marriage.
Wow. Wow. So it's very important for the family to also be involved and to know that, you know, if you're suffering, then it's also the family that is suffering. And that's why suicide is wrong, because you think that, okay, now I have relaxed, but you forget the people who love you. You forget the ones who love being around you. Of course, when you're depressed, you don't think about people around you. But if you take yourself out of the equation, there's somebody who's going to really suffer. There's somebody who's going to really miss you. There's someone who's going to really feel lonely without you. Your presence is so, so important, you know? And it's so important for also for us to think about the family and the friends and the people surrounding us when we are going through a time of depression. And that's why I like it in Denmark that they have courses for spouses, for children. They support everyone around this person who is suffering from this sickness. And I think it's a very, very important part of the treatment. You say that you not only survived depression, but your husband also survived depression. That is a really, really powerful statement. You know, I hope you out there have been encouraged by this, you know, interview. And I am actually here to tell you that that spirit will not take you out. You do not have to allow it. You will be delivered and you will be set free. Having negative thoughts in your mind is the same as having an injured body. We learned that, you know, your non-conscious mind, the one that stores all your memories, and it is responsible for who you are and your reactions, you know, and how you deal with the world around you. The conscious mind is only responsible for 1% of who you are. So it is very important for us to be selective of what we choose to put in our minds, because this influences our decisions. You know, Philippians 4 and verse 8 says, "Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, and whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things." Edith, I am so happy when you talked about all the scriptures you remembered and you put them there on the wall. This is your subconscious mind that was not taken out by your depression. Your conscious mind was not there. It did not realize that you were, you know, you were admitted at the hospital. And so I am very, very encouraged, and I want to say thank you so much for agreeing to actually talk with me today. You know, may the Lord bless you and continue to strengthen you on your journey. Great job with your job, with your, you know, relationships. I know you're very active in your church as well. And you are such an encouragement to the body of Christ. And especially during this season where people think that it's all hopeless. And just let us just accept everything that life is dishing our way. You're a fighter. You're an amazing woman. And your testimony, I pray that it's going to reach millions of people and that they will be encouraged.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.